Church, we're glad that you have joined us here this morning. He is still alive. He's still risen. He's still with us. Jesus is still active and alive in this world, interceding on our behalf. It's good news this morning, just like it was last week. So I have a call to worship for you from Psalm 33. It says, "Sing joyfully to the Lord, you righteous. It is fitting for the upright to praise him. Praise the Lord with the harp or the electric guitar. Make music to him on the 10-stringed lyre or the acoustic guitar. Sing to him a new song." We're actually going to sing songs that we know, but we're going to play skillfully and we're going to shout for joy because the word of the Lord is right and true. He is faithful in all he does, and he loves each one of us. And that's good news this morning as we get ready to come into a time of worship with him. We're going to have some announcements, and then we'll get started, but welcome to church.
His mercy's enough, his grace is sufficient. So come if you need it, forgiveness or healing. His mercy's enough.
Hey folks, important announcement. Baby day is upon us. May 1st in both services. Pastor Rochelle is going to give you some more details.
I have this wonderful sheet that I really need you to fill out if you're going to be part of this baby day celebration. And why wouldn't you? If you have a child 3 years old or younger, we want to see your baby. We want to celebrate them. First and second service, but you don't have to do both services. You can choose. It'll even say on here which service. Or if you'd like to do both, we'd have you in both. But I just need you to fill out the sheet. It is May 1st, so I need this before May 1st. And then you have a choice to decorate a stroller, or you can just put your child in a cute little outfit. You can have little brother or older sister walk them in, or you can walk them in as a family. Whichever way you want to do that, we want to celebrate them. May 1st, 9:30 and 11. Be there.
See her for more details. Build us a tank, Josh.
Thank you.
Hey, Jim.
Speak.
What are you doing next week?
Gonna eat lunch.
Where at?
Oh, what is that place? Golden Corral.
We're going to Golden Corral.
Yeah.
We're not staying there forever, but right now we're meeting at Golden Corral, the Old Codgers, which basically is if you're a guy, because young people go and old people go, mostly old.
And I'm young.
Yeah, you're young.
Sweet.
Well, don't get carried away.
Oh, okay.
Old Codgers, every Thursday, 12 o'clock. Get there a little early. We'll be there a little early.
Somebody will be there.
Hey, Grace, we need volunteers. We have several different places in the church where you can serve. One is in the nursery and the children's department. If you are geared toward kids, if you're gifted in dealing with kids, specifically preschoolers and nursery, we need your help. You can come and see me or Pastor Rochelle. Second place we need help is with our greeters and our first interactions with people. When they come in the door, some, if they're here for the very first time, they don't know where to go. They don't know where the kids go. Don't even know where the bathrooms are. We need help welcoming people into church, letting them know where everything is going to be. And then we need help follow-up. So you might or might not be geared toward kids or even geared toward hospitality, but your brain might work with details. We can use your skills. If you'd like to find a place to serve, come and talk to me, see one of our pastors, and we'll hook you up. Thank you.
Father, what a friend, what a savior he is.
Let's pray this morning. Jesus, we love you, God. Thank you for this opportunity that we have to worship you, God. We get to bring you glory. We get to sing your name and praise you above everything else in our lives, God. So help us to do that this morning from grateful hearts. Lord, will you take this praise, these songs, and just may it be music to your ears this morning, God. We want to please you and glorify you this morning. pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together, continue to worship him this morning if you can.
We worship the God who is.
listen to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung up on that cross and he rose up from that grave. My God's still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. This morning. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, this praise is all for you, God. Glory to you this morning as we sing.
The sound of a symphony to my ears is like holy water I'm basking. Dead man walking, slave to sin, I want to know about being born again. Oh God, I need you. So take me to the riverside. Take me on to baptize. I need you. Oh God, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like the sound of a symphony in my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. Your grace, God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me wanna change. I don't wanna abuse your grace, God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me wanna change.
Sing that again.
And I don't wanna abuse your grace, God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like forgiveness. It's like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. It's like holy water on my skin. Like holy water.
Praise you, Jesus, this morning. We lift up your name. Praise him this morning. Thank you, Lord. If God has healed you, if he has brought you through something difficult, just say amen this morning.
Amen.
He is good and he loves us. He shows us his favor and we don't deserve it. Lord, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your grace. So God, this morning we celebrate your story because your story intersected with ours and you changed everything.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Thank you, Lord.
My living home.
sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on thee. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope.
We declare your goodness this morning, Jesus, our living hope.
Let's pray together this morning. We have so much to pray about, and I've got a list, and I'm going to pray for those things in just a moment. But as we go to God in prayer, let me say something again this morning that I said last week. Did you know that last week was Easter? So what'd you come back again for? We got all geeked up last week, and it was exciting. It was Easter, and now it's just Sunday. Okay? There's only 51 more weeks till Easter. But I don't have to get up here and be hype man every Sunday, because he is still risen. What we said last week about Jesus loving you so much that he went to the cross in our place, that he went to show us the full extent of his love, and then God showed his power over death and sin by raising his son from the dead. That's still in effect today. I forget which service last week I said that we live right now. We live between Genesis 1 and 2, when God created the world and he made a garden. It was perfect. And Revelations 21 and 22, which is when he will come again and establish his kingdom forever. We live in the in-between parts. And I just got to tell you, sometimes not a fan. Okay? I want it to be the end of the story. I want him here. I want him reigning. We live in the in-between time where sin and death are defeated. They don't know it yet. So they're kind of like toothless Rottweilers. They can gum on you. They can inflict some pain. They think they're still alive. They think they're still powerful. But the sting of death, the power of sin, is defeated. And we get to live now according to that kingdom's rule. Because that kingdom, whether this world and this kingdom knows yet, that kingdom is at work today. And so what we're going to look at today in Matthew 5, again, God's kingdom is present now at work today. And we pray to a God who wasn't risen last Sunday and will be again next spring. He's alive today. Let's talk to our Heavenly Father this morning. Would you bow your heads with me? God, we thank you that the same Jesus that was alive and risen and living and at work in our lives last Sunday is alive and living and risen and at work in our lives today. And it's Sunday, the Lord's Day, the day that your kingdom gets bigger and the kingdom of hell gets smaller and smaller and smaller. But that's true on Thursday too. It's true tomorrow morning. It's true later on this afternoon. It's true that your kingdom has come, and we, as citizens of your kingdom, go out and live in this world that is loved by God. And we get to go and love the world because of your love in our lives. God, we thank you for the privilege it is to be a part of your church, your people. Your church today meets all over the world. Your church today lives and breathes on all the continents. Your church today calls itself Nazarene and Catholic and Presbyterian and Lutheran and Baptist and all those other names that we like, but I'm not sure you pay a whole lot of attention to. You, God, give us the love of Jesus, and we get to go and share that with the world. Thank you for letting us play on your team. God, you know our needs today. You know those in our church family that specifically need your touch, physically, emotionally, in their finances, in their relationships with kids and grandkids and with spouses. God, where we work, where we go to school, you know where we need you most today. God, we pray for Rodney Clark as he had surgery on Thursday. Lord, thank you for seeing him through. Continue to touch his body. Lord, be with Richard Hockingberry and Beth Bird. Lord, thank you for seeing Shirley Gregory here this morning. Thank you for seeing Teresa here this morning. God, continue to touch David and Pat Wright. Be with Faith Island and Virginia Justice. God, be with Dale Vector's daughter, Nikki, going through tremendous difficulties in her pregnancy. God, we pray that you would touch and be present and heal. God, give health. Jesus, we pray for Nikki and her family. God, be with Dylan Barnett and Ginger Barnett, Donald Thompson, who has surgery on Tuesday. God, be with Sean Collie. We pray for Dwayne and Melanie Harris and her cancer that has returned in her lungs. God, we pray that you would touch and guide and lead them. God, we pray for healing. We pray for your presence and for your will. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this service. You're going to say something today. Help us to listen. We don't have to ask you to speak. You speak. We do pray, God, that you would help us to hear your voice and apply your word to our lives this day so that our world would be different. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. I'm glad you're here this morning. As you saw a moment ago in our announcements video, Baby Day is next Sunday. If you have a little, if you have a child or a grandchild that is birth through three, we're going to celebrate your family next Sunday morning. We've got an information sheet that Pastor Rochelle has, and if you want to track that down, see me or Pastor Rochelle. We'll get that to you, and we'd love to make much of your kiddies next Sunday morning. We have volunteers that we need. We need help with greeters and first impressions. We need help with details, following up on people who have come. You know, it used to be that we showed up at your house, you know, and we expected like coffee and, I don't know, sweet rolls or something like that. We don't do that anymore. Okay. So we're not just going to come and knock on your door and show up at your house, but we would like to follow up and just say thank you for visiting with us and invite you back. And so those are some details, and I'm not the world's greatest detail person. I could use help with details. See me, see Pastor Joe about that. We need help with the preschool and the nursery. If you're wired that way, we would love to have you help serve. This morning in first service, we had Mark and Melinda Farabee, who were celebrating 20 28 years of marriage. And last week on The Lowdown, Scott and Christy celebrated 25 years of marriage. That being said, it's camp season. So we've got a bunch of kids to send to camp this summer. If you'd like to help send kids to camp this summer, you come and see me, see Pastor Micah, see Pastor Rochelle. We would love for you to help send some of our kids to camp. And we do certain things pretty well, and our camps in the summer, we do pretty well. We're going to receive an offering this morning. If I could have some ushers to come and to help, let's pray together. Father, we love you this morning. We thank you for loving us. Thank you, God, for Sundays. Thank you, God, for the privilege it is to be together. So we've got people worshiping with us online this morning. They're going to watch on Facebook or YouTube or on .online.church. We've got people who aren't able to be here. Lord, may there be a day where they're able to be here with our brothers and sisters in Christ. There's a reason you want us to be together, Lord. There's encouragement, there's teaching, there's help. So God, we thank you for the privilege it is to be together. Lord, thank you for this act of worship. We worship when we pray, when we hear your word, when we sing, and we worship when we give. Our hearts are changed when we give back to you, back to your kingdom. So God, would your kingdom come? In your great name we pray. Amen. Amen. So once upon a time, late one summer evening in Henrietta, Oklahoma, a weary truck driver pulled his rig off I-40 and into an all-night truck stop. The waitress at the Greasy Spoon had just served him when three tough-looking leather-jacketed bikers decided to give him a hard time. Now, in first service today, we had truckers and bikers, sometimes in the same person. So hang in there with me. Decided to give him a hard time. Not only did they verbally abuse him, you know, picking at him and poking at him. One grabbed the burger off his plate. Another took a handful of his French fries. And another grabbed his Coke and started sucking it down. The trucker sat and stared at the table. The bullies continued their verbal assault, and after a few minutes, the trucker stood up, picked up his check, walked to the counter, put the check and the money at the cash register, and walked out the door. The waitress followed him and stood watching out the glass front door as the big truck drove away into the night. When she came back to the tables, one of the bikers said to her, "Well, he ain't much of a man, is he?" And she said, "Well, I don't know about that, but he's not much of a truck driver. He just ran over three motorcycles out in the parking lot." We love stories like that. We love when the bad guy gets his. We love that. Okay, and I don't even know all the Marvel movies, but which one is it when Thanos thinks that he's got everybody defeated? Which one? Endgame. Okay, did I see that one? I don't even know if I saw that one, but he thinks he's got everything under his control, and then poof, he doesn't, and Iron Man has it. Okay? We love stories like that. We love when the good guys win and the bad guys lose. We love that. Jesus spoke to a crowd that loved when the good guys won and the bad guys lost. 2,000 years later, we're in the same exact position. All this year, starting from January, we've been looking at the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. We're finally done at the end of April. We're finally done with the first chapter. Yay! Okay, we're going to be in the second chapter of the Sermon on the Mount next week. So if you'd like to this morning, you can stand in honor of God's word. We're going to read a passage from the end of Matthew chapter 5, starting in verse 38. You have heard, now remember, this is the fifth and sixth time that Jesus says, you have heard that it was said, do not murder, but I tell you. You have heard that it was said, do not commit adultery, but I tell you. This is the fifth and the sixth time Jesus says the same thing. You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, which the Roman soldiers had authority to make you carry their stuff for a mile, but no further. Jesus says, if someone forces you to go 1 mile, go the second mile. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemy and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes the sun to rise on the evil and the good, and he sends the rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward are you going to get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You can be seated. We love stories where the good guys win and the bad guys lose, and Jesus comes along and says, love your enemies. And I did a deep dive this week. I just want to show you my cards before I started preaching, okay? In the Greek, love your enemies means love your enemies. He means it. And I'm going to give you a couple of particulars here in just a minute, but I want you to know from the get-go, Jesus means this. It's surprising. Sometimes we Christian folks, we are such literalists until we don't want to be. We love deep dives into Revelation. And we love to talk about the horses and the vengeance, and we love to talk about the dragons, and we love to talk about the payback at the end of the Bible. And then we read Jesus' words in the Sermon on the Mount when he's announcing his kingdom, and three little words, love your enemies. We somehow make ourselves the exception, and we're not. So in the first, there's two parts here, the eye for an eye part and then the love your enemies part. And the eye for an eye part is this. You've heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. That was limiting justice from the Old Testament. That was God's idea. For the Jewish people, don't, when you're seeking justice, don't go beyond the damage that's been done to you. If someone strikes you and you lose an eye, you can seek justice, but you can't take their life, an eye for an eye. If somebody comes and slashes your tires legally, you can go and slash their tires, but you can't steal their Labrador Retriever. Your retribution can't go past the wrong done to you. Well, in Jesus' day, they were taking this legal precedent and they were taking it personal. What you do to me, I'm going to do to you. And Jesus, again, like he has all through chapter 5, he's saying, this is what you've heard. Let me tell you what God's heart is saying here. Let me tell you how you can put into practice kingdom principles and show this world how much God loves this world. You've heard that it was said, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, but I tell you, don't resist an evil person. If someone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other. Now, this was an insult, okay, to be slapped like that. And again, you know, if somebody smacks me on one cheek, biblically, I'm supposed to turn to them the other. But I don't chase them down and say, please keep hitting me. Hit me again. Hit me again. Hit me again. We're not called to be doormats. But Jesus is saying when you're insulted, when you're taken advantage of, if someone sues you for your shirt, give your cloak as well. If someone makes you, forces you to go 1 mile, go 2. Don't demand repayment. Be willing, Jesus is teaching here, be willing to be insulted. Be willing to be taken advantage of. And I'll just say this at the, I don't like this. This does not feel good. It does not meet with my vigilante justice, trucker drives over 3 motorcycles love story. I love that stuff. But Jesus here is teaching in the kingdom of heaven, there are no bullies and victims. There is no payback and justice. There are people who love because God has loved us. And these are just kind of, they're kind of like little mini stories. If someone slaps you on the right cheek, turn the other. If someone sues you for your shirt, give them your cloak. If someone makes you go 1 mile, go the second mile. Jesus is giving just tiny little instances of this. In a world of power and weakness, authority and suppression, the haves and the have-nots, Jesus is teaching his disciples to let God be their advocate. And he's teaching that to us today. Let God be your advocate. Let God be the one who brings justice. In fact, if you want to be an Old Testament believer, you go right back to the book of Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18, and it says, do not seek revenge or bear a grudge. Anybody else have a difficult time this morning? I've come across so many great little nuggets that I wanted to share with you this morning, and this is one of them. Everybody's for loving your enemy until you have an enemy. Amen. We're all for this in theory until this theory's got skin on them and works with us or moves in next door or even lives in your house. You know, your very best friend, your spouse, can sometimes be your enemy. I mean, not in our relationship, but maybe in your relationship. Sometimes you have an enemy. Sometimes you have an enemy for a season. And did you know that in the original language, Jesus saying, love your enemy means love your enemy. Yes, you. Yes, that enemy. Yes, your situation. So the next part is, you have heard that it was said, love your neighbor. That's Bible. That's Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18. You have heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Go ahead and turn to the Old Testament passage that says, hate your enemy. I'll wait. It's not there. There is no Old Testament passage that says hate your enemy. Now, there's lots of instances of hating our enemies. There's lots of instances of God's people hating their enemies with swords, with chariots. There's lots of instances of the strong and the weak and the victors and the defeated. There's lots of instances of us today hating our enemy, but there's never been a teaching that is Christ-like that says love your neighbors and hate your enemies. Ever. Right down to today. And love, that next verse, love, you've heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, Jesus, remember, is talking to his students, his disciples. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Now, love is a tricky word. Okay? I love fall. I love when it's been real, real hot and it starts to get a little cool and I can go out and I can run without sweating bullets. I love that. I love burritos. I love my wife. Not necessarily in that order. And those words are the same. I love this, I love this, I love this. But it doesn't convey the same thing. Jesus here says, love your enemies. And if you know anything about those words that Jesus used, the word he uses is agape. Agape your enemies. Love as God has loved you. Love your enemies as you want God to love you. Love your enemies because God loves your enemies. We forget that sometimes. God loves my enemies. So don't try and weasel out of this. Here's what is in your control. Jesus challenges us, his followers, us today, 2022. Jesus challenges his followers to have an attitude and mindset of love. You are in control of your attitude. You are. You are. There are days that you can be driving down the road. I can be driving down the road and I'm golden. Everything's awesome. I'm listening to REO Speedwagon going down the road and I'm all in my own head and it's awesome and everybody's flying by me and honking and I don't give two flips about what's going on in the world around me because my life is awesome. The very next day, my attitude has changed. Everybody who goes faster than me is a maniac. Everybody who goes slower than me is a moron. Nothing has changed in the world except me. We're in control of our attitudes. Jesus knows this. Jesus says, I want your attitude toward your enemy to one of love because your attitudes lead to your actions. Jesus teaches his disciples, I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. It is hard to hate those you're praying for. Amen. So Debbie, if he's giving you a hard time, pray for him. It's a little bit easier to like him if you're praying for him. If your boss is the world's worst human being, you just get the luck of the draw that you work with the world's worst human being, pray for them. Is this easy? No. But it's what he's taught us. It's what he's taught us. Three things. We'll wrap this up. First of all is this. Jesus did this. Jesus didn't just give us, you know, a bunch of flowery language. Hey, have this as a goal. Jesus did this. In the last 24 hours before he was murdered on the cross, Jesus washed the feet of Judas, called him friend when Judas showed up to betray him. Jesus healed the wound of a priest's servant after Peter attacked him with a sword. Jesus refused to defend himself against the lies and the insults of the religious leaders and the Roman soldiers. He carried his own cross to Calvary. Then he literally forgave those who drove nails into his hands and feet. Jesus did this. Amen. Jesus never tells us to do something that he doesn't do. Well, Rich, I'm not Jesus. No kidding. The second thing is, Jesus tells us to do this. We're his students. We are his, this is a word I keep hearing lately, we are his apprentices. Some of you all had a job where you learned by being an apprentice. You followed the teacher. You learned by watching and learned by doing, learned by repeating. Jesus' disciples, Jesus' students, Jesus' apprentices, that's what we are to be. We are to see what Jesus does and do that. Jesus commands that. Everyone believes in loving your enemy until you have an enemy. Now, real quick, we are tempted to think sometimes that we are the exception. Like Jesus was on the hillside and he was saying to everybody, hey, you're supposed to forgive your enemies. Forgive your enemies. Love your enemies. Until 2022 in a little place called Clarksville, Tennessee, when Derek's going to work with a moron, he doesn't have to. He's the unicorn. He's the exception. He's the exception. The people that he works with are too horrible to love. But everybody else, you need to love your enemies. Jesus really means this. He did this. He told us to do this. Be careful that you don't so parse Jesus' words and you don't so look for the exception that you take the parts of the Bible that you like and you agree with and you decide to live by those, but this couldn't possibly mean me. This couldn't possibly mean my enemy. Yes, it does. Jesus loves your enemies. And he's going to love them through you. Do they always respond the way we want them to? No. No, they don't. So Jesus did this. Jesus commands us to do this. And finally this, we can't do this. You're not this good. You might not even be this obedient. You can try, but we can't do this without God's help. But he's promised to help you. He has given you the Holy Spirit. See, when we love our enemies, we don't love our enemies. Love does. Yes. Love does through us. Jesus does through us. Did you know that God loves your enemies? God might love your enemies through you. And we love God through loving others. We show God our love for him by how we love our brother and our neighbor and our enemies. In the book of Colossians, Paul writes this, Colossians chapter 3, starting in verse 12, Paul wrote to the church and he said this, as God's chosen people, that's you, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. Show mercy, show love, show forgiveness as you want God to do those things to you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. You don't love your enemies because it feels good, because it makes sense, because you want to. You love your enemies because Jesus has loved you and has chosen to love others through you. That's what it means to be his disciples. Jesus did this. He calls us to do this. And we can't do this without his power. I've got a video that I want to show you because I want you to have a picture of what this looks like. This is all good theory. But I want you to see this principle in action and the world-changing difference it can make one person at a time.
In a small apartment building in North Minneapolis, a 59-year-old teacher's aide sings praise to God for no seemingly apparent reason. Indeed, if anyone was to have issues with the Lord, it would be Mary Johnson.
For all you've done for me.
He never had a chance.
In February 1993, Mary's son, Loramian Bird, was shot to death during an argument at a party. He was 20. And Mary's only child.
My son was gone.
The killer was a 16-year-old kid named O'Shea Israel.
I wanted justice. He was an animal. He deserved to be caged.
And he was. Tried as an adult and sentenced to 25 and a half years, O'Shea served 17 before being recently released. He now lives back in the old neighborhood, close to Mary. This close.
He lives next door.
Next door.
How a convicted murderer ended up living a door jamb away from his victim's mother is a story not of horrible misfortune, as you might expect, but of remarkable mercy. A few years ago, Mary asked if she could meet O'Shea here at Minnesota's Stillwater State Prison. As a devout Christian, she felt compelled to see if there was some way, if somehow, she could forgive her son's killer.
What'd she say to you?
I believe the first thing she said was, look, you don't know me, I don't know you, let's just start with right now. And I was befuddled myself.
O'Shea says they met regularly after that. When he got out, she introduced him to her landlord, who, with Mary's blessing, invited O'Shea to move into the building. Today, they don't just live close, they are close. Clearly, Mary was able to forgive.
Unforgiveness is like cancer. It will eat you from the inside out. It's not about that other person. Me forgiving him does not diminish what he's done. Yes, he murdered my son, but the forgiveness is for me. It's for me.
For O'Shea, it hasn't been that easy.
I haven't totally forgiven myself yet. I'm learning how to forgive myself, and I'm still growing towards, you know, trying to forgive myself and what it is I've done.
To that end, O'Shea is now busy proving himself to himself. He works at a recycling plant by day and goes to college by night. He says he's determined to pay back Mary's clemency by contributing to society. In fact, he's already working on it, singing the praises of God and forgiveness at prisons, churches, to large audiences everywhere.
Forgiveness is a powerful thing.
Yes, I'm grateful.
Which explains why Mary can sing her praise of thanks to her audience of one.
All you've done for me.
One story, in a small apartment one situation, building in North one woman, one young man of forgiveness. Folks, stories like that are powerful. Stories like that will change one person at a time, and that's how Jesus changed the planet. And he's given us that work to do today. It's easy to love those who love us. It's easy to love those who are our brothers. It's easy to love those who are our neighbors and are like us. It's hard to love our enemies. But there's good news. You don't have to do this. God's love through you can help you to do this. And he's given us this work. Now, if I had a big old field and I was sending you all out into the field today to do work on my field, I'd fuel you up before I sent you out. I'd give you big old breakfast. Jesus invites us to the table. Amen. So we can strengthen before we go out and put what he's given us to do into practice. So in just a moment, I'm going to invite you to come to the table, and you're invited to come this morning and receive the cup and the bread and the juice. I'd invite you to come to the Lord's table this morning, not just for the, you know, stalest tiny little piece of bread and a half a teaspoon of grape juice, but to receive Jesus, to go out into the world that needs Jesus, to go out into a world that needs to know the love of Jesus. We receive him not just so we're bettered, but so that we can go out and change the world. That lady's story is overwhelming. I heard you groan. I heard you groan when you saw where that young man lived. I heard you. First service did the exact same thing. Oh. She invited him. That was God's love through her. Amen. Tell me that's not powerful for that young man. Much less what it did for her. A life-changing instance happened in that young man. It could very well be chin rub, sky stare. It could very well be that God will change your enemy through how you treat them and love them and forgive them. It could be. Maybe not. But love can do that through you. Micah, would you and April and Matt, would you and Kim come and help me serve this morning? I'd like to ask the band to come, and I would like to ask you to stand. We're going to pray together. And as we pray this morning, After we pray, I'd invite you to come. You're welcome to come and receive communion. You don't have to be a part of our church. You don't have to be a member. I'd like for you to come and to take the cup and hold on to it. We'll all receive together. And if when you come this morning, if you'd like to spend some time at the altar and just continue that conversation with the Lord, you're welcome to do that. Would you ask Jesus to help you to put his words into practice? This is not natural. This doesn't just come freely, but he will give you the power to do it. And he truly does mean, because he showed us in his own example, he truly does intend for us to love those who are bad to us, love those who persecute us, love those who mistreat us. You don't have to go on vacation with them. But we're told to love them and to pray for them and to work for their eternal good. That's our job. Sometimes we love the jobs that Jesus gives us. Sometimes not so much. But this is the work that he's given us, and he's given us his example to follow. Would you bow your heads and pray with me? Father, this is hard. This isn't natural. We love the story of the trucker who runs over the bikes. We love when the bad guys get theirs. We love when people don't get away with it, when they mistreat somebody, much less us. We love when the good guys win and the bad guys lose. But Jesus, you loved me when I was a sinner. You loved me when I was far from you. You loved me when I disparaged your name. You loved me when I was a rebel. And if you have loved me like that, I can love others with your love. If Jesus loved and forgave those who were crucifying him, we can love and forgive those who aren't crucifying us. You love our enemies, so we need to love others with the love that you give us. Amen. God, that doesn't come natural, and this is hard, but you've promised to give us your power and your spirit and your love. We need it. In your great name we pray. Amen. If you'd like to receive communion this morning, you can step out of your section to your right, come forward, grab one of these little cups, hold on to it. We'll receive together as the body of Christ here in just a moment. If you want to start wrestling the little clear thing on top of your communion cup, that'd be awesome. Paul, speaking to the church in Corinth, he said that on the night that our Lord was betrayed by an enemy, but by a friend, on the night that our Lord was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had blessed it, he broke it and he passed it to his disciples, saying, "This bread is my body broken for you. As often as you come together, eat and be grateful. Take and eat this morning." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had blessed it, he passed it among his disciples, and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you, to give you life, to give you strength, to give you mercy and forgiveness, grace, love to share with others. Drink, receive Christ this morning. Take and drink." Jesus, we thank you that what you did, you've given us that work to do again. And you mean for us to do it. That is how we change the world. One situation, one forgiveness, one act of mercy, one enemy of the time, the kingdom of heaven can get bigger. God, open our eyes to the people in our lives that need to be loved by the love of Jesus. Help us, Lord. Show us, give us those opportunities to love, to agape, to work for their good. Help us to pray for them. God, give us those opportunities and those people to show the love of Jesus. In your great name we pray. Amen.
My Redeemer, there is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Side, the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hold, my Shepherd will defend me through the
Your strength, Jesus, your power, your will, your way. God, help us. Help us with our attitudes. Help us understand the way you love through us into the world, God. Give us foresight as we go into new places this week. Prepare us ahead of time, God, so that we can love like you loved us. Be gracious, kind, merciful, and as good as we can be as we walk your way and follow you in this world. Give us strength. We ask this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Let's sing the doxology this morning together.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
I've already had some of them. I've had some of them. Oh, Rich, you don't know my enemy. You don't know what they've done to... I know. But Jesus loved you. And Jesus loves the world through you. And you get to show God your love for Him by how you treat God's kids. You show your love for me by how you love my wife and my kids. It's the same with God. We show our love for Him by how we show love for those that belong to Him. And it just so happens to be that there's about 8.9 billion knuckleheads running around the world today. And we get to go and love on them. So gird up your loins, church. Let me bless you as you go today. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Go and love others as God has loved you. You're dismissed.